That better?
Yep. All
Okay.
right.
I
So,
can.
Tony, welcome to the program. We are live on Facebook, and I'm really excited that you're joining me again on the program. So, this is Deborah Rue, and you're listening and watching if you're watching us on Facebook. It's Human Potential at Work. And so, I had to have one of my favorite guests back. He's a hero to many of us, former Congressman Tony Coelho. And he lots of interesting things going on, Tony. So welcome back to the
Well,
program.
there sure are. But before we start, I'd like to acknowledge that today is the 6th Global Accessibility Awareness Day. And I know that you had Joe Devon on the show, as I understand.
Yeah, great guy. Great guy. We had him on Access Chat.
Access Chat. He is great. I just wanted to acknowledge that.
Yeah, 6 years, and he did it because he came up with the idea because his father had become blind and could not get access to basic banking information.
Oh, I
And
see.
so he wrote a blog about it, and Jennison, who is an amazing leader in the field and also happens to be a man that's blind. He agreed that we should have some kind of accessibility awareness day, and now we do, as you said, 6 years today.
That's great. I'm really proud of that. That's fabulous. Good for him.
Yeah, every day should be accessibility awareness day, but
Shouldn't have a special day. It should be
that's
every day.
right. But a lot of really amazing events going on all over. So, but Tony, tell us what you're doing because I have always tracked your career, and you've made so many amazing, you've had so many successes. But I know a lot of our audience know about your work, but just in case people don't know about your work or they haven't seen, as a reminder, there's another episode of with Tony that's available on the podcast. But tell us about your work. So it might be a repeat to some, but it's a great story. So tell us a little bit about your history.
Thank you, Deborah. I will. When I was about 16 years old, I had a crash with a pickup truck into the canal down the farm that we own, and I hit my head. And when I got out, I had a headache, but I wasn't really too worried about that because we had totaled the pickup, and I knew my dad would not be too happy. So,
Least of your worries at the moment, right?
Things went on and nothing else happened. And a year later, I was in the barn milking cows, and all of a sudden, I don't remember what happened. My brother, I had fallen into a feed bin that we fed the cows with. He picked me up, took me into the house, and when I woke up, there was a doctor there. He was sitting on me. That's why we practice medicine, I think, in that rural part of California. But anyway, he was sitting on me. I just had convulsions. So I couldn't speak. I could hear. And they were talking about what was going on. And what I didn't know is that the doctor told my parents that it looked like I had an epileptic seizure. My parents believed, because of church views, Catholic Church, that if you had epilepsy, you were possessed by the devil. So they refused to accept the diagnosis. So I went to three other doctors. They told me that it was lack of calcium, lack of this, lack of that. But I never really talked to the doctor. They talked to only my parents. And so finally, I just kept on having seizures. And by the time, and then after the doctors, then I went to three witch doctors. And I went through the whole episode with three different witch doctors. And obviously, they didn't get rid of those evil spirits. They were still there. And I kept on having seizures. And then I went away to college and I would have seizures. But I just treated them like they were a severe headache or something like that. And I wake up and I'd keep going. And so then, and I was very active in student government in college. And when I decided to graduate, President Kennedy had just gotten assassinated, and I decided that I wanted to devote my life to public service in some way, just like he did. And I decided to enter the priesthood, and I got rejected because of my epilepsy. because if you have epilepsy, you're possessed by the devil. Canon law established in 400 AD said you couldn't be a priest. So I became very concerned, upset. I couldn't get a job. My parents rejected it, wouldn't accept it. I felt that everybody that I'd ever loved in my life or anything had turned against me. And I'd get drunk every day on this hill. I thought it was a mountain at the time. But this hill in Los Angeles, Griffith Park. And I finally, one day I was contemplating suicide. And one day I heard some music and I looked and it was merry-go-round. And little kids getting off and on that merry-go-round, laughing and carrying on. And I heard a voice and it said, "You're going to be just like those little kids. You're never going to let anybody or anything ever stop you from doing what you want to do." And that was it. A cloud was lifted from me, and I went back to the university and so forth. And about a week later, a priest said to me, "I have an opportunity for you to live with Bob Hope and his family." And I loved it. So I went for the interview. I got it. I lived with the Hopes for a year. He became my turnaround agent. He said to me one day, he says, "You think you have a ministry and it only can be practiced in a church. The facts are is a true ministry is practiced in business, in sports, entertainment, in government. And where you belong is in politics. That's where you belong." And so I wrote a letter to my congressman after that, got a job, and I took off for Washington, and that started my whole career. And I've always given Bob Hope the credit for my career because that's how it started. And I then was a staffer for 13 years for my congressman, the area where I was born and raised. And when he decided to retire, he wanted me to run in his place. I wanted to run, and I got elected easily. And so I served my time there. But when I got elected, I decided that I wanted to pursue my ministry. And so I would take care of agriculture and water issues for the district, but that my ministry was disabilities. And I wanted to amend bills, do things, make a difference. And that's when I started amending and realized that amending bills wasn't really that fruitful because we as people with disabilities didn't have our basic rights. Right. And so that's when I introduced the Americans with Disabilities Act, which would give us our legal rights as people with disabilities like other groups do, women, gays, people of color, and so forth. And so that was the whole movement. Now, grassroots-wise, all across the country, there were people demonstrating and pushing to have their civil rights. And so I just basically went into that movement, introduced the legislation. And of course, it got accepted and signed into law by President Bush, Papa Bush, as I call him. And it's now the law of the land in 52 different countries. And our law has grown in its enforcement. The Justice Department has a responsibility to enforce the law. And so it's worked effectively. You go on every street corner, you'll see curb cuts. Employment, they can't discriminate against you and so forth. So there's all kinds of things, but if you don't have enforcement, the law doesn't do any good. And that's true with any law. So the Justice Department under President Obama had, and the Civil Rights Division headed up by Tom Perez was very aggressive in regards to enforcing the law. And so we made tremendous progress on ADA enforcement. And my concern now is whether or not that's continue to be enforced. That's my concern. But that's what I've done after that. Then President Kennedy appointed me to President's Committee to Hire People with Disabilities. I did that for 6-7 years. I can't remember now. And then he appointed me as the Task Force for Employment for Adults with Disabilities. And that was 7 cabinet officers, and I was the only non-cabinet officer. But that was, we got things through there. It ended up with the census question in regards to disability. Now we have a factual count on that. It also pursued the 503, which requires federal contractors and subcontractors to hire people with disabilities, as they do with women, as they do with people of color.
Right.
It's the law that was never enforced. So that task force really was aggressive, and we did a lot of great things. And I've always been absolute in that I have to pay back, because I'm so lucky, so fortunate in what I've been able to do and so forth. And I just am committed to making a difference for those of us with disabilities. And my next episode, because I think at 75, I still have responsibility. So now I've started, and it's not announced yet, but I don't mind telling you, it's the Coelho Center on Disability Policy. And we're aggressive on that, and I'm excited about it. I'm excited what we're gonna do there. And so we'll be announcing that later in the year. And it's, I think there's gonna be a great opportunity to continue what I'm all after. And so that's my storyline in regards to what I've done and what I intend to continue doing. Now, the only other thing I did, as you know, Deborah, I talked about it when I was last on with you, is that I decided that it was critical to make sure that people with disabilities was involved in the political process.
Right.
So what I did was to set up a group of people to support Hillary in her campaign. And we had over 215 people working on policy issues. And we developed policy issues in a bunch of different areas. It was employment, it was health, it was technology, it was all different areas. And we came up with a bunch of different policy ideas, put it in a booklet that she could use during the campaign, and that hopefully would use during transition and when she governed. Obviously, there was a little problem with that in November, but we still did it. We raised $2 million, which the community had never done. And we had a convention that was totally involved with disabilities. Every speaker, major speaker, talked about disabilities. The first time that had ever happened. And since then, I've been very involved with her campaign after she got nominated. And that was very, very effective. She did one speech totally on accessibility for people with disabilities, inclusion for people with disabilities in Orlando, Florida. It was fabulous. And then we're working with Tom Perez, the DNC, to make sure that folks with disabilities are included and aggressive. People don't realize that the number of people with disabilities, when you include family and loved ones, it's the largest community outside of women right. in the country. And then I just feel that we need to recognize that in every possible way. And if we don't, it's a big mistake. And so I'm aggressively doing that now. And so those are the things I'm working on.
Well, so you just don't sleep, I think, because it's amazing what you've accomplished, especially when you had so many odds put against you. I mean, you know, the demons inside you and all that ridiculousness. But there's so much I admire about you, Tony, but just your career has proven what one person can do. And I know that you always involve a lot of other people in the efforts, and you know it takes all of us together. I got my AAPD newsletter yesterday, and I was, you know, looking at it, and I was like, oh, great. Here, and I'm reading it from my iPhone. 2017 NBC Universal Tony Coelho Media Scholarship. So it was like, oh, and then Tony's doing that too, that together they're going to offer 8 scholarships to undergraduate and graduate students with disabilities who are interested in pursuing careers in communication, media, and entertainment industry. And I thought, that's beautiful. So
one of our big problems is in regards to the whole media industry, movies, radio, TV, whatever, the whole industry is that people with disabilities are portrayed by somebody without a disability.
Right, and
we're not included as if you're put in the corner and patted on the head and say, we'll take care of you. I'm totally against that. And so these scholarships would go to people with disabilities who want to get involved in the media industry. And that, in effect, means that they will be seen on TV, they'll be involved and so forth. And we then create a different image for those of us with disabilities. It's happened with women on being included in real ways in media. You now have women as anchors and so forth on TV programs. It also happened with people of color, the Jeffersons, and I can go on. But once media addressed them as normal human beings like everybody else, sort of has helped change the attitudes and so forth. And gays have done that, and it's worked very effectively there. And we haven't aggressively done that. That's one of the things that I feel strongly about. And, you know, I want people to think that I'm naive. It takes time to do all these things. I think, quite honestly, women haven't solved all the problems that, yes, there's still discrimination and so forth. People of color, the same thing. Gays, the same thing. So we, in our community, we aren't up to snuff like these other communities. But if we're aggressive, our numbers are there, we should be aggressively pursuing it. I only want to add one thing, Deborah, that I don't want people that are listening to think that I'm not religious. I'm very religious. I'm Catholic. I go to church and so forth. And when I was WHIP, I'm going to tell this story, that when I was WHIP, I had the right to take a foreign trip with a delegation. And of course, as being a Portuguese, that I would go to Portugal. So we did that. And then the State Department wanted me to go to Morocco because the King of Morocco was working with the Portuguese in regards to the Middle East. So I said I'd do that. And then I had a choice of what I wanted to do. And I said, I want to go to the Vatican and meet the Pope, Pope John Paul II. So we had pre-approved, very boring speeches and so forth for he and for I. Mm-hmm. So we get there and he comes in and we all get up and then everybody sits down and I go to the podium, this is in the Vatican, I go to the podium, and I give the very boring speech. At the end of the boring speech, I say, Your Holiness, I cannot live with myself if I didn't say something personal. As a young man, I decided I wanted to become a Catholic priest. I was rejected from the seminary because I have epilepsy. Canon law established in 400 AD said that if you have epilepsy, you're possessed by the devil, you can't be a priest, and that's still in existence today. 1987. I wish that you'd look into it because I think it's very Christian of our church. We walked out. He was walking out the door, walking out to the door. My wife, he was holding her hand. So we walked him out to the door. He turned and blessed her. He did not bless me. And so I thought I was going straight to hell. And so then he said to me, young man, I heard your comments. Turned around and walked away. 2 years later, individuals with epilepsy can be priests now, and there are several that are priests. And I want to make it clear that I don't take credit for that. I only know what I did. I don't know what triggered John Paul to do it or to pursue it, or maybe it was already in the mix, but I know what I did. And the reason I bring that story up is because I think as an individual, you can play a big role if you want to. I take the view that whenever you have the podium, it doesn't have to be a physical thing, but whenever you have the opportunity, you have to speak up, educate, and try to make a difference. That's what I've done all my life. That's what I really believe in. And those of us with disabilities have to be willing to speak up and speak out. And that's what I believe in very strongly.
And I totally agree with you, Tony. And one thing that I see a problem with our community that I love so much, this community that we have. But, and as you mentioned, some of the numbers, According to the World Health Organization, 1 in 7 people have disabilities, over 1 billion people in the United States, 1 in 5. The numbers are staggering. And sometimes I'll hear people say, you know, when they're trying to pitch a corporation or you've got to include us, you know, it's like you're leaving money on the table if you don't include us. But the real reality is that we still don't speak cohesively as a community. And you've mentioned like the LGBT and the women. Those communities have done a better job, I think, than we have. Now we're starting to find our sea legs, you know, but what do you think we could do? Would it be beyond, you know, things that we are doing, like the work you're doing with Loyola and AARPD and AAPD and the programs like mine and Joyce Bender's? And what can we do to break down some of the internal barriers that we have in our own communities so that we can pull together? And I'll give you one more point, Tony. I just interviewed Rebecca from the Carter Center, and we were talking about mental health and stigmas and stuff. And that's part of our community too. Absolutely. And so what can we do to continue to break down the silos, even the silos we have between the Democrats and the Republicans on these issues, the silos in the biggest sense of the word that prevents our huge community and the people that love our community of really progressing further?
You've hit it on the head. Silos, silos, silos. Silos is our biggest problem.
Yep.
When I worked for the Hillary campaign, I was determined not to have silos. So we got, in effect, 250 individuals with disabilities, of all types of disabilities, all ages, all ethnicities and orientation, whatever. We got 250 people, and we operated as a disability community, not as a part of a disability community. And it worked. We were able to raise the money. We were able to do things and so forth. The other example I have on that is when we did the ADA. The ADA, we didn't have silos because everybody knew this was critical for us.
Right.
But the silos keep coming up. And I understand it. There are particular issues for different groups that are in the disability community. And those are critically important. But we got to get people realizing that we're all in this together.
Yes.
And if we work together, we can help out each of the individual disability groups get what is needed, what is fair, what is right. But we have to come together in order to do it. We've done it a little bit lately with some of the people that have been appointed to the cabinet, like Secretary of Education, who is so negative on programs for those of us with disabilities. And the community was very organized. So we're getting better at it, and we're seeing that we can be effective when we do that, and that's kind of exciting. So it is starting to come together. And the Coelho Center that I'm working on, that's one of our goals, is to work with everybody and bring people together, because we can't be as strong as we should be if we don't come together. Because when you consider the numbers you gave in regards to those of us with disabilities, if you include loved ones, if you include those that help us, those that need assistance, it is a huge number. And so we can be very effective if we do it. The good news is that the disability movement is now a consideration. People come to us politically now. So the recognition is there. If we can deliver on our votes and deliver on our cohesiveness and so forth, we can be extremely effective. But we're not quite there yet. But the fact is that people are coming to us now, wanting our input, wanting our involvement. That's a step forward.
I agree. And I think another thing that's very exciting, I was thinking about, I work a lot with corporations. And this week, I was saying to my husband last night, I have talked to probably 10 of the largest corporations in the world just this week alone, And it's so exciting because they're, you know, wanting to put together media campaigns to show that they are employers of people with disabilities and are very proud of that. And they want to make sure they have access, and they want to make sure that their connected homes and their connected products are accessible not only to people with disabilities, but people that want to age in place. And it feels like we're having a tipping point. It feels, I am optimistic. And I, you know, Tony, for a long time, I didn't talk about my invisible disabilities, my depression that I, and anxiety disorders that I have really struggled with, because to be honest, I was embarrassed. I didn't want anybody to think I was weak or anything. And I started realizing, along with the ADHD, that you actually have to talk about it, because it just shows you're not broken. You're not filled with demons, Tony. You just are a man that you are many things. You also happen to, have, epilepsy as part of who you are, but we're made as these multidimensional, beautiful beings, I think, and we've got to celebrate it. And we've got to keep looking ahead.
A quick story on that. Joyce Bender tells us all the time, where we met many years ago when I was head of the president's committee to hire people with disabilities. She came in, so she was talking to me, and she said, I have a seizure disorder. I've done X-ray. I said, whoa, stop. What do you mean by seizure disorder? And she said X, and I said, you have epilepsy. And she said, well, my doctor said never to use that word because of the stigma.
The stigma. We were just talking about that. Voice.
You've got to use it. You've got to use the fact that you have epilepsy, because if we don't, we'll never get rid of the stigma. So by saying you have seizure disorder, you're in effect participating in the stigma that is out there. So we got to fight and go at it. And so that, you hit it right on the head, that those of us with disabilities got to be willing to say who we are. I have been very successful in all kinds of different positions on Wall Street and in business and political and so forth. And I still have seizures. I'm 75 years old. I still have seizures, but that hasn't marked me as an individual who can't do things. It has really, in a lot of ways, enhanced me in my determination to do things. And so we in the disability community have to take this and in our own hands and deal with it. If we can't say we have a disability and be proud of it, then nobody's ever going to respect us for our abilities and what we can do.
I agree. Well said. And when we were, we had recorded a show right before this that'll come out next week. And we were talking about really, that you can actually, there are benefits, to having disabilities, there's benefits. And once again, I probably sound like a Pollyanna, but the reality is, what I have had to do in my life to manage this depression and anxiety. And it's funny how it just sometimes just come and sits on my chest. And what I've had to learn to do, for example, just a little point, my husband started having some issues, and I, like a wife, started cramming omega-3s in him. And I thought, oh, I should take the omega-3s too. Barlean's, I'll do a commercial, Barlean's omega-3. And I started doing it. And after a few weeks, I noticed that my depression symptoms were getting a little better. And I thought, oh, I guess I need more omega-3. I didn't realize that. So everything that we do as human beings, it can impact us. And, but I want to ask a question. A lot of our viewers have young children with disabilities. What would you say to a parent who just found out their child has trisomy 21, like my daughter, Sarah, or autism, or, epilepsy? What do you say to these parents of these young children? What do they do? What do they do for their children? Where do we go from here?
Well, the one thing, I speak to a lot of parents groups, one of the things I always say is, remember that love can handicap. You can love somebody so much you, in effect, don't let them be who they are.
Guilty sometimes.
Yeah, and you're always concerned about this or that or whatever. And I always say, do you do that with your other children? And of course, the answer is no. And so, but there are degrees of a disability, as you well know.
Right.
There are some children who can't function at all and so forth. So I'm not being hard-nosed on this. I'm just saying that it all comes down to the attitude of the loved one. Are you giving that child, that person, an opportunity to do what they want to do, or an opportunity to do what they can do, no matter what it is? Are you giving them an opportunity, or are you in effect sheltering them by you're doing everything, some of the things that they should do? And I always say also that you need to let us make mistakes, because if we don't make mistakes, we'll never succeed. That's how you learn. Every child, that is what happens. And so you've got to let us make a few mistakes or do something wrong so that we learn from it and then develop ourselves. And that's true no matter what degree of disability you have, to a great extent. And so I plead with loved ones, particularly mothers. I plead with loved ones to make sure that you're not loving too much. And I've spoken at a lot of different groups, and I have a lot of the mothers crying and so forth, because I've hit it right in the head with them, is that they're overprotective and they realize that they are. But it is a problem. I had a woman call me one day when I was the House Majority Whip, and she was crying and on the phone and was insistent upon talking to me. I didn't know her. And so my secretary came in and said, this woman is on the line. She's in Los Angeles, and she's just crying and carrying on and insisting on talking to me. I said, well, I know what the problem is. So I put her on. So she told me she had a 18-year-old son who had epilepsy, and he knew about my career, and he wanted to go to college. He wanted to go to a college that wasn't, so he wouldn't be at home. He was staying in the dorm. And she said, I'm just really concerned that something will happen to him and so forth. And I said, ma'am, you have a right to be concerned. I said, do you have any other children? She said, yes. I said, what? And she said, a girl. And I said, how old? And she said, 21. I said, did she go to college? And she said, yes, she's very successful. And I said, great. Did you treat her the same way? I said, you obviously, there are problems. I understand all that. But don't love us so much that we can't succeed. If we don't fail, we'll never succeed.
Oh, and so true.
It's a hard thing, but I learned it the hard way. My parents didn't mother me. They didn't believe what was happening, and that was the best thing for me. And I thank God for my epilepsy. My epilepsy made me into the person I am today and made me realize that I could be strong and I could overcome a suicide. I could overcome negativism, and that all I had to do was believe in myself. And that's what we should all try to do.
I agree. And I thank God for your epilepsy too, because look at the lives you've impacted, millions and millions of lives. So Tony, thank you so much for being on the program again. You really honor us with your wisdom. I hope that you live to 125 because we got a lot of work to do, and you are a blessing to our community. So thank you so much, Tony.
Thank you very much, Deborah. Appreciate it very much. Appreciate being on your show.
Sorry, guys. I was watching it. I was watching
and mesmerized.
It I was oh, watching you were? It. There's a delay okay. on on I Facebook.
Was... It was all right, though?
It was great. Let me hold on.
Beautiful, Tony. My God, great. You start talking and I get mesmerized.
Yeah.
And boy, really there have I walked with my daughter, trying to hold her back and her fighting me every step of the way. So, wow, that was amazing, Tony. Thank
it
you.
Was.
You're good. You're
I was watching good. It. I was watching it out here, too. So, yay, so yay. I'm still, what happens is, there's it's about a 30-second delay between
Well, thank you, Doug.
Thank you so much. Yeah, great job, Tony, as always.
Yes. And Tony, we're going to also put this on. Well, I'm going to tell Michael all of this, but we're going to put it on YouTube.
Okay.
Where it's going to be on Facebook. We're going to, Doug, I forgot to turn on Audacity, but
That's
I think I have
right.
a good
fine.
One.
Okay, you were fine.
Yeah, so. Good. So, and then we're going to strip the audio out. I say we're. Doug is going to strip the audio out, and then we're going to send it to Stitcher and Empower Radio and iHeart Radio and all the places that it goes.